All right, welcome back to part two of Smark Guys for October 30th. Again, it's a Saturday, so it's a little bit different. We're actually going to talk about last night's SmackDown.
It's the Halloween episode.
Yeah, the special Halloween edition.
Happy Halloween.
So basically on SmackDown, following the pay-per-view, the big thing was Undertaker lost the Buried Alive match, so what was going to happen. Really weird, strange promo that it runs when SmackDown starts. It shows Undertaker walking through a hallway.
Why don't you tell me about the new entrance to SmackDown? The new opening.
There was a new opening?
With the song and all.
That's because it's been like a month now they had that opening.
We never talked about it.
Oh, how they have a Green Day song now as their song, and it's really weird because it's like, it's out of place. It doesn't.
That's strange.
What I've been thinking, every time that I watch SmackDown, I think, I remember when SmackDown had the Marilyn Manson song, Beautiful People. Mm-hmm. That song fit the show perfectly. And ever since then, every song they picked has been weirder and weirder and weirder. Every year when they have their season, you know, launch, the new season of SmackDown. And this year now they have a Green Day song. And don't get me wrong, I like Green Day and I like the song, but it just doesn't seem to fit the show.
You should have like Longview or those songs at the opening.
But anyway, so they have this really weird Undertaker promo. He's walking down a hallway and he opens a door that seems to be like beaming light, and he walks through the door, and that's the end of the promo. You have no idea what it meant.
He went to hell.
It almost seems like it's alluding that he died and went to heaven or something.
He's dead, yeah.
So really weird.
He's in heaven now. He's going to come back with some angels. He's going
to
fight.
So the show really opens with Kane and Paul Bearer coming out to the ring, and Kane basically saying, all right, I beat The Undertaker. Let's have a moment of silence for him. Because even though he hates him, it was kind of weird. It's almost like he did respect him, even though he hated him. So he wanted to have a moment of silence for his brother. He basically says The Undertaker's never coming back. He's gone from WWE. And then all of a sudden, Alberto, of all the people, Alberto Del Rio pulls out in this freaking Excalibur old-ass car, which is hilarious. They're like, what? It was like the biggest contrast of what could possibly happen. There's like a moment of silence at one thing, and then Alberto Del Rio pulling out in this old classic car.
Yeah.
So he comes to the ring, and of course, you know, Kane is irate. He's like, who the hell do you think you are? What are you doing coming to the ring during the moment of silence? Del Rio attacks Kane. It's like, huh? And then all of a sudden, Rey Mysterio comes out. He attacks Del Rio. He actually does a 619 to Paul Bearer. Edge comes out to add to this clusterfuck. Ends up spearing Kane. It's just like, what is going on? But you can tell where they're leading. What ends up happening is that a triple threat match gets set up later in the night between Edge, Mysterio, and Del Rio. And the winner's going to get the number one contender shot.
Okay.
So it makes sense. It's just really a really clusterfuck way to open the show.
That's how you get, you know, into a match. You just come in,
you just
know,
come in
out
and
show up and fucking attack people. Like, all right, you're going
to
shut
in, a classic car. You need to have a classic car,
okay.
Apparently.
If you didn't have that, you wouldn't have gotten in there.
So now for the third show in a row, we had a pay-per-view and Raw. Now for SmackDown, the same match, we have another rematch, Dolph Ziggler against Daniel Bryan.
It's a good match.
Match number three. Once again, another good match. Every time they have this match, it's good. Mm. I almost feel guilty. Like, maybe WWE knows that this is the best match they can put on right now. So maybe that's why for three shows in a row they've been giving
it's a good way to make both guys look good and get them on the show.
So it goes back and forth. It's pretty much a really good match. And then, basically, it's a really weird ending because there's a ref bump. So the ref's kind of like half out of it. And Ziggler legitimately hits the zigzag and is pinning Daniel Bryan. He would have won the match, but the ref is like out in the corner. So Vicky gets in the ring because she thinks she's the SmackDown consultant. She goes, 1, 2, 3, Ziggler wins. And then the ref wakes up and says, no, I didn't see it. This is bullshit. So then they get into this big verbal argument. In the meantime, Daniel Bryan super kicks Dolph Ziggler in the face and wins the match. So it's really weird. And the thing that I don't get is where they're going with this angle, because now you've had two matches in a row where basically Dolph Ziggler didn't technically lose the match. In one match, his foot was under the rope. In the next match, he actually had a 3 count, yet they keep giving the wins to Daniel Bryan. And I don't know if that's because they don't think Bryan's strong enough right now to legitimately win a match against Dolph Ziggler, or maybe this is just some really weird angle they're trying to go with Ziggler that just keeps happening.
Is it a way to keep Ziggler looking decent, maybe? Maybe look some protection in a way?
I don't know.
Really? It makes Daniel Bryan look like he has to get lucky to win.
Right.
I hope they go win a CM Punk, Daniel Bryan direction.
If they do, and that's why I also thought this was weird, because on Monday, they were setting up this angle that CM Punk was scouting, and he had watched Daniel Bryan, and when Daniel Bryan won that match, he actually applauded. Now, here it is, the same match on SmackDown, CM Punk's not there, so it's like, are they going to drop that angle, or is it only going to be on Raw?
Well, he left SmackDown.
He did leave SmackDown.
He hates SmackDown now.
But it seems like everyone's crossing over whenever the hell they want anyway, so really, I don't know.
Yeah, those guys had good matches in the other places, so it would be excellent if they don't let them have a match.
There were a lot of weird backstage promos on this SmackDown. Kelly had a promo with Cody Rhodes where they were trying to both use the mirror at the same time, and Cody was trying to hog the mirror. Then Big Show came and said, listen, you know, stop being an asshole, basically. And Cody was like, oh, well, you know, I would wrestle against you tonight to settle this, but I'm a tag team wrestler now, and I team with Drew McIntyre. We just lost the titles, but that's okay. We're still a tag team.
Yeah.
And so Big Show says, all right, I'll find a partner, and we'll go out and we'll challenge you. So that's like a preview of later tonight what a match would be coming up. Up next, another match. I hate saying another match with Caval, where he comes out. He wrestles Jack Swagger this time. Jack Swagger comes out with his eagle mascot. Mm-hmm.
That's actually Chavo.
That's Chavo. Yeah. Is that going to be like an angle later on?
I don't know. I don't really care either.
So he comes out with this eagle mascot, and Caval, again, a really good match. Every time you see Caval in the ring, I mean, I followed this guy back when he was in TNA, when he was called Low Key. Mm-hmm. He's a solid wrestler and really impressive some of the stuff he can do because he is a smaller guy. They won't let him win a match in WWE. Since he came to SmackDown, he has not won a match.
He's a joke character.
I just don't understand why they're doing this.
He's like the Santino of SmackDown.
It's just
like a joke.
I don't know. Basically, he taps to the ankle lock. You know, Swagger gets angry because the match is going on too long. He smashes his leg against the ring post. He puts him in the ankle lock and wins the match. So
ankle lock is so bad.
Well, it's just not real ankle lock anymore.
It's so stupid.
You know, when Kurt Angle was first doing it.
Well, first Shamrock did it, and then
right.
Angle did it. And now, this dude's name. Kurt Angle's done it for so long now, it's like, just let him have it.
Yeah.
Something else, man.
So, this was the special Halloween episode of SmackDown, which we forgot to mention. So, they had a Divas Halloween contest. I did not write down who everyone dressed as because I didn't give a shit, and the match was pretty sloppy. And basically, it was really weird because it started out slow, then it actually started getting a little good. And then they cut the commercial. When they come back, Kelly pins Rose, it's over. It's like, the match actually happened during the commercial on a show that they record. It wasn't live. So why, maybe the match was so bad they didn't want anyone to see it and they just put it in a commercial, right? Yeah. I don't know.
Editing.
So up next, there was the match with McIntyre and Rhodes against the Big Show and his mystery opponent. And it was really weird because Rhodes and McIntyre came out and started talking about Nexus. And saying, Nexus, you won our titles, but it's bullshit, we're getting them back. And from now on, we're called the Dashing Ones. I'm like, okay, that's kind of a crappy name.
Like, Tyler Rex wasn't on the show. Wasn't he in the new star?
Same thing with Zeke. You know, or these guys were on the pay-per-view for bragging rights, and now they're off the show.
It's kind of weird. What, you know, they're supposed to be top guys now. They're on the show.
Right, top guys. We'll never see Tyler Rex again. He'll be mopping the floors next week. So then Big Show comes out and pretty funny. A fan had like this wig, this yellow afro wig because it was Halloween. They were dressed up, and Big Show takes it from the fan, puts it on, and walks in the ring. He's like, "Yeah, so what the hell is this?" And then he ends up that Kofi Kingston is his partner, and they actually announced that Kofi Kingston's going to be on Ghost Hunters tomorrow night for Halloween on Sci-Fi, which is pretty cool. They do this every year on Sci-Fi. They have like a live 6-hour show where the Ghost Hunters go to some haunted house, and they've been taking wrestlers. 2 years ago they had CM Punk on there, and now this year they have Kofi. So
okay.
That's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. So anyway, it's a good match. It's really weird because we mentioned this, I think, last week, but Cody Rhodes is against using moves of Gold Dust. And this he keeps he the move where he no not where he throws himself up, the move where Goldust drops to the mat on his back and slaps up his opponent. Cody Rhodes uses this in every match now, and it's like, is he taking moves or are they training together? Like, there's something weird going on.
We should talk about the stand up for WWE stuff this week.
I'm skipping all of this. We don't even at this point politics.
I've worked for 15 years in this company. They're the commands are the best ever.
We talked about this last week. The WWE is under attack right now because Linda McMahon's running for Senate in Connecticut, and so everyone's saying, how could she be a good senator when her company has wrestlers that die?
They're
irresponsible and all this.
On my drive in to your house today, I heard a Linda McMahon on the radio, like an advertisement.
Oh, yeah?
And her position now, like what she's promoting, is that she's not a career politician. She goes, I'm only going to serve two terms. because I'm not a career politician. Huh. But two terms is like 12 years.
Right.
And she's like 62 right now. So it's like, really, Linda, you don't want to run for a third term when you're
really
like,
when you're dead,
when you're in your late 70s. You know, you are a career politician, I guess, you know. So
anyway, that's just an aside. They are running these promos.
Oh, by the way, at the polls on Tuesday, mm-hmm. they first said that you weren't allowed to wear WWE merchandise.
That's right, and then they overturned it this week.
So now what they're doing is, at certain polling places, the WWE will be there handing out free merchandise.
Nice. I'm going.
So you should definitely go.
Nice. Yeah. We should go and wear like the most offensive wrestling gear ever. Yeah. Like, you know,
I wouldn't vote for Linda, but yeah.
Dressed like Val Venus.
I'll take a purple John Cena, you know, shirt, whatever it is.
Okay, so anyway, getting back to the match, Big Show and Kofi Kingston against McIntyre and Rowe, the Dashing Ones, which is their new name. Pretty decent match. The way that it basically ends is that Big Show chokeslams Rhodes for the three count, but it was really weird because what happened was, I guess Drew McIntyre was attacking Big Show, and then all of a sudden, he wasn't the legal man, so Big Show kind of pushed him away, which kind of like scared him almost, that the guy was so powerful. He goes to chokeslam Rhodes, and Drew stands there and watches him get pinned and doesn't break up the count. And for heels, it's like, why would you not bring up the count? Heels always break up the count. So then after the match, there's actually a backstage clip where it's Rhodes and McIntyre arguing, and Rhodes is like, I don't understand why you didn't help me. And he's like, well, he's a giant. What do you want me to do? They end up arguing, and then they break up. So they just formed this tag team called the Dashing Ones, and now they're broken up permanently for good. So a one-night-only event. And then it was the main event, Triple Threat. And this was, probably one of the best matches I've seen this year, I have to say. Because this match, it was a long match. They gave it enough time. This could have been on the pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Every one of the guys, Del Rio, Mysterio, Edge, were hitting their finishers. They were all kicking out of their favor, doing reversals, pinning combinations. Extremely good match. And then finally, at the end of the match, Edge ends up winning. So Edge will be the number one contender to face Kane at the next WWE pay-per-view.
That's kind of weird, right?
I mean, I think they want to continue the angle with Rey and Del Rio at this point, because it really kind of ended abruptly because of bragging rights.
I guess there's no one else really to put in that position, because Kane's going to maintain the belt till Undertaker's back.
I think that's why they moved Edge over to SmackDown to begin with, because they didn't know who they wanted to push to wrestle Kane. So
they shuffled
him back over there in order.
They could have done something a little different, like Kofi Kingston gets a shot or something like that. You know, someone that one of the big baby faces that needs.
I guess.
To, I mean, I don't know, whatever, but. So that, Edge and him is probably more something that could sell better.
Right. So that's it for WWE this week. Now on to TNA Impact.
TNA Nitro.
As John likes to call it.
Well, that's what it was this week. Definitely.
Because basically, this show, the more that you watch it, it's mimicking exactly what the WCW used to do. And it's like, what are they doing? They're going right down the same path.
TNA is so inconsistent. They'll have amazing shows, and then they'll have horrible shows.
Right.
And this is one of those horrible shows that mirrors Nitro.
Well, the whole first 15 minutes of the show is six of the knockouts fighting in the back and spilling into the actual ring. And
that I felt was better than the typical, like, I'm Eric Bischoff, I'm coming out right now.
Sure, yeah. I mean, at least it was a different way to open the show.
It went on a little long.
I thought maybe it could have been for 3 minutes and then they could have stopped it rather than 15.
After a couple of minutes, you got the idea and it didn't really build anything. They were just kind of punching and throwing.
Right, and it wasn't like anyone was getting hurt or nothing.
Eric Bischoff coming out in the beginning, though.
So it was basically, on one side you had Mickie James and the Beautiful People. The other side was Tara, Madison Rayne, who's the current Knockouts champion, and Sarita. So they're fighting, all going crazy in the ring. No one can break them up. So Ric Flair comes out with the two security guards, and Flair's trying to break them up, and all of a sudden he gets slapped by Tara, and then slapped by Mickey, and he's getting, oh my god, and he starts freaking out, and he's like, who do you think you are, my ex-wives?
Yeah,
and, you
know,
I'm gonna. I thought it was weird because I don't know if how many people know this, but Flair's gotten arrested for beating his ex-wives. So for him to say something like that, I was like, oh.
It was almost like an inside joke at Flair that he's had like six wives, so once you go in there and like, you know, interact with these six women who are like slapping you.
Very weird.
It was kind of, why is he the one that comes out? So it was kind of strange. So, and then, like, he makes a match for later?
Well, that's what I was just going to say.
Why don't they just have the match there?
Flair says, oh, we're going to have a match later. And it's like, you're right. If they're all there, why don't they have it then?
Just get over then.
I don't know. They ended up, he announced that there was going to be a six women tag match later in the night. And then all of a sudden they ran a promo that the main event was going to be Anderson versus Double J in a chain match for the main event. But Anderson, if you didn't watch last week's Impact, near the end of Impact, Jeff Hardy had hit Anderson with a steel chair, and they didn't really show it on air, but Anderson actually got a concussion, real concussion. His head got gashed open, and this guy, I mean, you could see his freaking skull, and they kept showing this constantly during Impact this week.
So there's no reason that something like that should go on in this day and age, after we know all the problems that wrestlers have.
Right.
There was no reason for him to get a direct chair shot right to the head like that, that eventually caused a concussion.
Right.
And then to make it worse, they had an entire show that was based around this real-life thing that happened.
This concussion was the running theme of this week's Impact, is that Anderson has a concussion, and people keep going to Bischoff and telling him, you can't have this match tonight against Double J, because he has a concussion. First it was the trainer, the head trainer came and said, I don't condone the match, and Bischoff said, tough shit.
Oh, whatever, it's what wrestlers do. They go in there and they fight with concussions.
Then Matt Morgan, out of nowhere, now who's Matt Morgan in this plot line? He never had anything to do with this before, and he's supposed to be part of Fortune, so he shouldn't
care. It's weird, man.
But he all of a sudden is really concerned, says that he had multiple concussions in the past. So he tries to talk to Flair, who
came out of nowhere.
Off. Then he talks to Bischoff, and Bischoff blows him off. Basically says, get the hell out of my office. I don't want to hear about this bullshit.
It came completely out of nowhere, because last week on Reaction, I'm watching it, and he's going, oh, this brilliant plan that we had. So he was such a member of this faction.
Yeah, it makes no sense.
And also his character, he was trying to like kill Hernandez for like 3 months.
Right.
So all of a sudden,
and now he's concerned about giving someone a concussion or wrestling with the
right.
Concussion.
So the entire show became like a public service announcement about concussions.
About concussions. But we'll get more about that when we get to the main event. But anyway, so there was this angle where Pope was coming to the ring with a casket because he wanted to basically. So he was challenging Abyss, and he says, Abyss, I want to take you out, and all that.
Have we seen enough caskets in wrestling?
I don't think so. I think, actually, there should be one casket match per show, every day, every time.
What did do you hear what Taz said when they first showed him wheeling it?
Yes, he says, I hope that's not a,
he was like, I hope you don't see a badass fighting a UFC
guy next.
Yeah, something like that.
Something weird. You know, that was an allusion to what had happened at UFC.
There was two or three references to WWE.
Yeah, there was, which was weird.
So it was like a Nitro, because Nitro used to do that. Stuff like little stupid inside comments. Like
so Abyss comes out, says, I'm going to get rid of you, Pope. You know, how dare you challenge me. Really weird, he grabs two fans and runs to the back. So it's like he's kidnapping these fans on the show, which is really weird. And later on in the show is when they came back to it, but just we might as well get it over with now.
The Pope had to like think about it before he had to like ran up the thing.
Right, Pope chases like, Abyss to the back.
At first he like stood there for a while, like thinking about what to do. Right. He's like, oh, yeah, we gotta run after stuff.
So he runs after him. Later on in the show they cut back and Pope is hearing the screams of these fans, help me. He rushes in to help, and Abyss ambushes him, beats the crap out of him.
What was he doing to that chick to make her scream like that?
I don't know.
What was going on there?
He's showing him his face. He took his mask off. He's like, ugh.
Maybe he was showing something else. I don't know what was going on.
So he beats down Pope, puts him in the casket, and then they cut away. So it's pretty obvious that Pope is getting out of the casket during this time. Then he finds Janice, which
Where's Janice?
2x4 with all these nails in it. And then he beats the casket, which damages the casket. But you know that obviously Pope's not in there, so it was really silly.
You know, it was silly, and why doesn't he open the casket and hit him with the thing instead of, you know, hitting the top of the casket, a metal casket with a fucking
with a 2x4. So really weird.
Even if he wasn't, I don't think he would have gotten hurt.
Now you want to ask, is Pope going to be out or whatever? Will this be an angle? Who knows? So, let's see.
Samoa Joe's dead still. He still wasn't there.
Right. The only update, that's the next thing I was going to talk about. The only update on that is that apparently Double J wants to wrestle him at Turning Point. He wants to have a match with Joe at Turning Point. But Joe is just not even on the show this week. Robbie E versus Jay Lethal. So Robbie E, if you missed it, is this guy from, he's the Jersey Shore knockoff. They call it The Shore. Mm. And back and forth match. Robbie's okay, I want to say. He's not super impressive, but he's not
decent.
I want to say he's not bad. He wasn't like green. You could tell
he's been around some. His name's Rob Echoes, and he's been around different places.
Okay.
But the gimmick is just so dumb that you don't want to really get behind the gimmick.
Yeah, it's a really dumb gimmick, and the stipulation of the match was if he wins, he gets a title shot for the X Division title against Jay Lethal.
And he was god-awful.
And, yeah, exactly. What happened was his manager, Cookie, has hairspray and sprayed.
She didn't even get anywhere near his face.
No, she sprayed Jay Lethal supposedly in his face, even though he didn't look like he ever touched him. He can't see, and then Robbie gets the RKO, even though I don't know what they call it for him. I don't know. I don't know what they call it, but he gets his finisher and wins the match. So it sets up a title match for the next pay per view for the X Division title.
I hope he doesn't win, please.
They still have this really weird angle going on where Angelina Love is seeing Katie Lee, who used to be in WWE, and apparently they released her. Now she's in TNA, but they haven't even announced that she's there yet. She's showing up as like this delusional character in Angelina Love's.
This is one of those moments where, as a wrestling fan, that you are embarrassed to be one.
Yes.
I was actually watching this part when like, my family members came in.
Oh, yeah?
And saw me watch, like, sat there for a second, and just like, what the fuck are you watching? I felt like an asshole. So it's one of those moments where...
That's actually their new catchphrase. TNA makes you feel like an asshole.
I felt like a fucking ass for watching this, and it was an embarrassment.
So yeah, another really weird thing. We don't know what's going on with Katie Lee, if they're going to call her that, what she's going to be when she debuts in TNA. But she works for TNA, apparently. Up next, it was EV2, basically came out to the ring and said, listen, we were trying to contact RVD for a whole week, and he's not answering our calls, emails, or our tweets on Twitter. I was like, what the fuck, our tweets on Twitter? Really? So then RVD comes out, and it was really funny because I guess Spanky is part of EV2.
They call him Spanky now?
Yeah, they call him Spanky, and he was sitting in the corner reading Mick Foley's biography. I don't know if you saw that, because they didn't really show it on camera.
I actually did watch the entire show, I missed that. I think I was probably in another room.
It was hilarious. He was sitting in the corner, and they didn't focus on him. I just thought it was hilarious. It was that angle from, you know, a week ago, where he went to Foley's book sign. He's sitting there reading the book.
Like, where in the ring?
In the ring.
Oh, I didn't even notice
that. In the corner reading the book. So anyway, so RVD comes out, and... basically, he doesn't trust anyone. He doesn't trust
He doesn't care about Jeff Hardy anymore, or like anything, or anything like that.
He forgot about the title. He forgot about Jeff Hardy.
He's just concerned about one of the
members. There's a traitor in EV2 that's talking to Eric. So then he actually gets back and forth with Raven, and actually accuses Raven of being this traitor. And then Fortune comes out and basically challenges RVD and Raven to a tag match, and it was supposed to be Kazarian and Doug Williams.
No, it was EJ and Kazarian.
I'm sorry.
And then Doug Williams starts saying, getting complaining or whatever.
That he wants a match. He hasn't been in a match for a while. So then all of a sudden they take Kazarian out of the match and put Doug Williams in the match, which is a really weird angle. Like, what I think they're trying to lead up to is that there's dissension in Fortune, even though Fortune's a relatively new group and they just built them up as being strong.
They're showing there's dissension in EV2 and there's dissension in Fortune, so you don't know who's swerving where, and this is crazy, so I better turn in next week to find out, because this is really interesting stuff. I want to know who's swerving and what.
Really weird. So anyway, that sets up the tag match for later in the night. Then the women's match takes place, and the match is still out of control. The women refuse to get in their corners. Finally, they get some order to the match, and it's okay. It's an okay match. I have to say the knockouts are probably a lot better than the Divas of WWE. They actually have wrestling training, and they know what they're doing for the most part.
James, Tara, and Sarita are pretty good. The other ones are okay.
Yeah, the end was really good when Sarita actually does a tiger bomb on Velvet Sky. Like, what the fuck? And she actually did a really good, you know, professional move to finish the match.
It's probably the best thing on the show was that.
For wrestling, kind of wrestling-wise, pretty much.
It was pretty scary considering that's a women's match.
Right? Up next was a triple threat match for the tag team titles, which is weird because they were already running promos that Team 3D was going to wrestle the Motor City Machine Guns at the next pay-per-view because they were retiring and they wanted to go out on top. But then they have a triple threat match for the titles. It was Generation Me against Inc. against the Motor City Machine Guns. Really long match. It's a usual tag match for TNA where there's a lot of spots, there's a lot of crazy stuff, and everyone loves the match.
Oh, that was probably the best match. I'm sorry.
That was definitely the
best
match.
That's probably the best thing on the show.
The Motor City Machine Guns retained.
At least there was an actual match with a finish and things that went on.
And no screw jobs or anything or abrupt endings. Team 3D hits the ring. They challenge the Motor City Machine Guns officially in person, and finally we get an answer. Yes, the Machine Guns accept, and they're going to have this match going at the next pay-per-view.
Yeah.
So we finally have an answer that's definitely happening.
The word going around is that Team 3D has like a 2-year contract.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if this is going to, maybe they'll get screwed by like one of the other teams will like screw them, and then they'll
and
be
then
like
sets up like a program.
Maybe perhaps, I don't know. We'll see what happens with that. That's probably one of the better things on TNA right now.
So then they run the Turning Point card, which is the Turning Point is the next pay-per-view. It's going to be Mickie James versus Tara, just a match. It's not even a title match, just a match. Team 3D against the Motor City Machine Guns for the tag titles, a retirement match for Team 3D. Anderson versus Jeff Hardy for the title, but there's a giant question mark behind that because Anderson supposedly has this concussion, and we don't know if he's going to be able to come back. Plus, he has this crazy chain match tonight with Double J. No one knows what condition he's going to be in after that. So then we have the tag match, AJ and Doug Williams against RVD and Raven. Goes back and forth a little bit. Basically, what ends up happening is Raven, first of all, gets double teamed by AJ and Doug Williams, and RVD just walks extremely slowly to the ring and lets him get his ass beat. Because apparently the plot is that RVD thinks that he's the traitor of the group, so he doesn't give a shit. But then they do eventually start wrestling for real. But once that ends up happening is Raven gets knocked out of the ring, and then Ric Flair comes out and hits Raven with the belt, which basically knocks out Raven. Now RVD goes for the hot tag, and Raven's not there, and RVD says, "What the hell? What are you doing over there?" And RVD gets pinned, and so...
So stupid. It's like, how did they know that, you know, Raven would be on the outside, like, take advantage of that?
Right, it made
just like last week, how did they know that Sabu was going to throw the chair and hit him? And,
right. Makes no sense.
Dumb.
The other weird thing that happened is that, to win the match, it was actually Doug Williams jumped off the turnbuckle and hits RVD with a move, and he goes for the pin, but while he was jumping off the turnbuckle, AJ slapped his ass, which constituted a tag, so AJ then got the pin, and now Doug's like, what the fuck, I won the match, and you get the pin, that's bullshit. Mm. So this is more dissension within Fortune, supposedly, that's what it's supposed to allude to. So now we have the main event, which is hilarious.
Yeah.
So you're supposed to have Double J versus Anderson in this chain match, and they play Anderson's music, Matt Morgan comes out, and they're like, what is Matt Morgan? And Morgan says, listen, Anderson's not coming out, I'll take his place. We'll have this match. So he has a chain on him for some reason. They go out. They start their...
Well, because the match was going to be like each guy holds the chain.
And they... Right.
And then
right.
They fight with the chains.
Okay. So it's a chain match. They beat the shit out of each other. But basically, Double J wins. But then Matt Morgan attacks him after the match is over. So that then prompts Fortune to come out. All of Fortune comes out, beats the crap out of Matt. So basically turning on Matt Morgan, kicking him out of Fortune. And then they proceed to lynch him with the chain. And I thought that the days of lynching people on TV and professional wrestling were over, but I guess that we were kind of going back to
that. I kind of appreciated that thing.
Oh, you appreciated the lynching?
I don't say I appreciate lynching, but it was a strong visual that, like, this guy's out of the group.
Oh my god, I just don't get it.
It was too far, is what you're saying?
It was stupid. It was stupid. Like, beat him down, throw him out of the group. Why do you have to fucking lynch the guy with a chain? Like, you're right. They still think they're in the Attitude Era. They really do.
They go a little further, but...
You know what I mean? Like, they think that they're still in competition with WWE like they were back then, when it was really head-to-head WCW against WWE.
So it's like a shock thing?
I could say back... If they did that in the 90s, I would completely understand why they did it. Why they're doing it now is just...
All right. Beyond me. That's where you're coming from with
so.
That.
All right, so that was a lot to cover in this week's edition of Smart Guys. No pay-per-views coming up this week. For the first time in a while, so we're going to just have a regular episode next week, where we'll talk about Raw, SmackDown, and Impact. Overall, what do you think, John, of the product?
WWE is childish nonsense. TNA is retarded, confusing nonsense.
I don't know. I still think if I had to choose between the two, I would still pick WWE right now. I am still interested in what's going on with the Nexus stuff. My one complaint is all the freaking stipulations that they've had for matches in the past.
I can't really say what, like, I like this one better. They both suck.
So yeah, it's right now, it's just really, I don't know what, I think they're both trying to get their game plan ready for next year. Being that TNA just had their big pay-per-view, and the WWE, about this time of year, is when they start to gear up for WrestleMania and figure out what they want to do at WrestleMania. I think that's what's happening.
Yeah, this is typically the slow time for WWE,
yeah.
Traditionally.
Right.
Once you get to, like, the Rumble in that time of year, it picks up.
Right.
What they're trying
so
to
this
do.
Is like this, they're gonna take a couple months to try to figure out what they want to do and once they hit the Rumble, and I think that's what they're why they're shuffling the cards.
TNA again, they're overdoing it. Like, these guys swerve.
Right.
These guys, who's gonna swerve? That's almost like this what they're selling to you as a fan reason to watch.
Is there's gonna
who's
be
gonna
a swerve?
Go, who's gonna join which group?
Right. Is it gonna be someone? Is EV2 gonna have a traitor? Mm-hmm. Is Fortune gonna have a traitor? And Fortune ends up does have someone who they kick out of Fortune. You know what's going on?
And, yeah. Whereas it should be like I want to watch this because there's good stuff on it.
But the one thing I do want to say.
I just want to say, they're assholes for how they handled the Ken Anderson thing.
That was stupid.
Like, he shouldn't have gotten a concussion in the first place.
Right.
The reason that should have happened, and then to make a show that's basically like a PSA about concussions is like just. It's not very classy.
And the other thing I don't understand is, now this was supposed to be their whole reboot, and now the Immortal is the name of the group that's in charge.
Mm-hmm.
There was not one mention of Immortal on the show this week, and Hulk Hogan wasn't on the show. And he's supposed to be the head guy, and he's not on the show. So
he's having, like, physical issues, so he's not... he's not going to be on much.
I can understand, but then if they knew that, they shouldn't have had him be such a big part of this whole takeover thing. They should have had Bischoff and then say, oh, Hogan's not part of it because he's hurt or whatever. So that's my complaint for the week. But anyway, all right, that's it for Smart Guys. We'll be back next week, and we'll see you then.